equally decisive and firm when it comes to smacking down hard on what we see from the outside as the dangerous rise of communal sectarian hate and violence in the India of Narendra Modi.
Well, I think Mr. Modi has been quite clear in his mind, in his own personal interventions, that he sees these issues as a complete distraction from the main task, which is to build the economy, take India to the road of progress.
When people are being killed because of their beliefs, yes. Because, for example, a Muslim man happens to own a cow, and some people down the street believe that he has slaughtered a cow, and he is murdered for that.
There have been hate crimes in India, and I would say that constitutes a hate crime.
That's not what Mr. Modi has ever said.
Mr. Modi may not have said it. Mr. Modi has said there is he called for a 10-year moratorium.
Mr. Modi on Twitter is seen to follow people who peddle hate and who celebrate when a Muslim young man is murdered because he's falsely accused of slaughtering a cow.
We all follow lots of people on Twitter just to get a diversity of opinion.
Okay, he's the Prime Minister of India. Is that not irresponsible?
I mean, he follows me. I mean,
I suspect you do not declare celebration when a Muslim man is killed.
No, certainly not. Look, in India, we have all shades of opinion. Some of them are ugly. And I think I would be the first to admit that there are certain people who believe that Mr. Modi's victory also symbolized their liberation from what they see as the scourge of secularism and avenge history. Now, there are these people.
Avenge history.
Yes, so there are people.
You surely know more than anybody else that Mr. Modi is seen by Muslims in India and many outside as a man who still has a cloud hanging over him because of what happened in Gujarat in 2002. You know that there are still serious allegations about his role as chief minister in riots which killed many, many hundreds of Muslims. Given that past, surely your advice to him, and you do speak to him, is to be as tough as he can possibly be on what you call hate crimes, but that is a phrase he does not use.
No, he does not use.
Do you think he should?
I think what Mr. Modi has to do is to make sure that the political agenda moves decisively away from these sectarian issues. That the political agenda is focused principally on the question of development, and that identity politics of such a narrow variety actually sees. Now, how you do it is really the question.
Forgive me for interrupting, it's rude, but it is so important, this. I just wanted to air the figures. There's a phrase that's developed in India over the last few years called cow vigilantism.
Yes. It is a real serious problem.
And look at the figures. I've looked at the last 7 years. 97% of the incidents of this cow vigilantism, which has resulted in violence, sometimes the deaths of people seen to have believed to have slaughtered these animals, 97% of the cases reported under Modi's government, and most of them in BJP areas. So the party has a problem, Mr. Modi has a problem, and it doesn't seem to be being addressed.
I think what's very important to realize is that vigilantism is completely unacceptable. It has been made so, it has been declared. Various chief ministers, party functionaries have said so. Whether individuals take the law into their own hands, they must be dealt with. However, I would also emphasize one thing, that beef is one of the most emotive issues, which in India, it's got to be handled with kid gloves. There's a lot of sensitivities which are involved there. And I think you've got to play that issue very diligently.
That a little bit. Are you saying to me that you defend the right of Indian states to categorically ban the slaughter of cattle, not just for Hindus, or not just to make it a voluntary faith-based requirement, but to actually say to every single citizen of the state, you cannot kill and therefore eat beef?
Such legislation exists.
I know. Are you saying
that? Most of the legislation was not passed by the BJP. It was passed by previous Congress governments. That's a part of the constitution, which also says that it's part of the duty of the people, of the government, to protect the cow. Now, you might find this antediluvian. You might find this contrary to certain customs here. But in India, as I said,
well, beef is
a very sensitive issue in India. I think personal tastes sometimes, just like prohibition, temperance. Why are so many things, why are so few states against alcohol consumption? They've actually enacted laws against it. Sometimes they don't work. That's a different matter altogether. But there are these sort of taboos. There are these social restrictions which are there in India. And they have to be handled with a great deal of sensitivity.
Mr. Modi and his background and his tone. Let me end this particular point by quoting to you the words of Gandhi himself from 1947. The Hindu religion, he said, prohibited cow slaughter for the Hindus, not for the world. The religious prohibition came from within, and any imposition from without meant compulsion, and such compulsion was repugnant to religion.
Mr. Gandhi certainly was one of those greatest advocates of anti-cow slaughter.
But his point was that he must not make it voluntary.
There are states which allow cow slaughter to take place. I think also there has to be a greater degree of realization and accommodation on the part of people to say, look, this is what I do, but this is not necessarily what you do.
Are you worried?
And I'm saying that this is a social issue. It goes far beyond politics. But at the same time, I think it's very, very important to emphasize that beef is a very sensitive issue.
Well,
it's a very
made
part
that
of that
Let,
Indian culture. It's a part of Indian culture.
Let's leave beef to one side for a moment and just end with this thought about whether you are concerned that under Mr. Modi, there is something happening with Hindu extremism. I'm now thinking of the recent murder of a journalist who spent a lot of time researching and talking about the dangers of Hindu extremism, Gauri Lanka. She was brutally murdered in September 2017. Are you worried that there is something happening in India today which Mr. Modi and his team are not capable or indeed willing to combat?
I knew Gauri very well. She was a colleague at various points. I don't think there's anything as yet to link her murder with that of Hindu extremists. I think it's one of those really grim tragedies that happen, that attack and murder of Gauri Lanka.
You see no link to her writing.
As of yet, there could be. I said there could be. I'm saying that, however, I think the important thing is to realize to isolate these Hindu extremists as much as possible. Most of them, incidentally, operate outside the boundaries of the BJP. They find the BJP too moderate an organization. They believe in a very extreme, radical, exclusivist view of society, which goes against the beliefs and the sensitivities of
but
most
then why,
other people.
Why is your party, the party you're loyal to, so keen to offer sops to these people? For example, in the education system, one can look at states like Maharashtra, where efforts are being made to completely change the textbooks that your school children are seeing and reading to write out whole swathes of Mughal Muslim history. Why is that happening?
History in India is a very contested issue. I think it's important to also recognize that history has been written in one particular way. It was written earlier by the colonial masters. Subsequently, at various times, there's been an influence of the left on history. And I think there is
a critic of what is happening said we may soon have the absurd situation where students in Maharashtra will not be allowed to know who built the Taj Mahal.
That is silly. I think that's a caricature. That's not what is happening. There have been certain extreme cases of some people saying, oh, the Taj Mahal shouldn't be, but I think they'll be laughed out of court. What is important is to recognize that India had a certain contested history. Now, how we find a method of actually accommodating these various conflicts is really the challenge. It's an intellectual challenge. It's a challenge for historians. But to say that we should go by the earlier version of what constituted history, I think is wrong.
There's no question that Mr. Modi is very popular. I mean, he's won regional state elections in the last few months by resounding margins. His opinion poll ratings are very high. Do you also, as a man who's a writer and a explorer of India's social affairs, do you also have worries about what Modiism is doing to India?
If you think that Modi's success, his popularity, is due to a certain vision of India which is ugly, which is monstrous, which is exclusivist, I think you're wrong. There have been certain very, very fundamental changes in India. There have been a lot of actual government, a government which is seen to work at the grassroots, which is there. That is what really caps it. The rhetoric, his personal charm, his eloquence, etc., those are just the garnishing. The real substance comes from the fact that after a long time, we've got a government which is perceived to be relatively honest, which is committed, which delivers.
We have to end there, but Swapan Dasgupta, thank you.
Thank you.